Hello everyone, Alec Elder, the SideQuest Gamer here, and welcome to another spectacular episode of the SideQuest Gamer Review Show. This one took a while, but for good reason. If 60 plus video files tells you anything, I'll be reviewing the indie action RPG known as Veyron's Wrath. It's a rather new release and you probably haven't heard of it, so I just want to give some spotlight to this game. Is it any good? Well, let's find out! Revenge is a dish best served cold, as the villainous superhuman Khan Noonien Sin from Star Trek II: The Wrath of Khan would tell you. It's not often do we play as a protagonist whose primary motivation in the game is solely based on revenge. I mean, we do have games like Turrican and God of War, where the protagonists have a personal vendetta against the groups that they're trying to kill. In video games, we often play as heroes who are depicted in having the moral high ground, and the revenge narrative isn't as easy to depict the character in such a way. The concept of wrath being the sole motivation shows the character as angry and feral instead of the good guy you would come to expect. But sometimes we don't want to play the good guy. Sometimes we just want the character to achieve their goal because sometimes we feel the ends justifies the means. And Veyron's Wrath is one of those games. This game was developed by Mubo Corps and released in 2016, but only in the French language. The English version wasn't released until 2017. I've been following this project for quite a while now, like since my second year on YouTube in late 2015, where I got a message from the developer saying they liked my Star Tropics review and asked me if I would be interested in voting for Veyron's Wrath to be greenlit on Steam. So I saw the preview and really liked what I saw from the footage, so of course I voted for it. I don't just vote for any game to be greenlit, as I hold a high standard to which games deserve to be on Steam, and knowing the overabundance of shovelware, I really am selective about what goes on Steam. And since the English version was released, Marcio of Mubo Corps provided me with a Steam key of the game for free, so the nature of this review doesn't have the buyer's empathy, but I will try my best to see if it's worth the $15 asking price.
With that out of the way, let's finally launch this game, and if you don't want to hear any spoilers, I'll just give you a timestamp to the overall summary. But if you don't care, let's get started!
The game begins with Veyron, who kind of looks like your typical anime tough guy, practicing his sword fighting technique on a scarecrow until a blonde girl approaches him. He's annoyed with her presence, and she claims he promised to hang out with her while the village prepares for a festival of some sort, but he denies making the promise, tells her to go back to the village, and she angrily walks away.
Real smooth.
This is where you head down the cliffs and into your village. On the way, there are hints telling you how to control your character, and while the gamepad is an option, for this review I used a keyboard because why the heck not? There are gaps and enemies ahead, and here we learn to jump over small gaps, kind of like the tile hopping mechanic in Star Tropics, which the developer has cited to be one of the inspirations for this game. It's simple, but it gets the job done. And of course, there's a bunch of blue gelatinous enemies and turtles that are easy to take out. These enemies get you used to the basic combat of the game and just get used to the feel of it. It's really as simple as pressing the F key while avoiding any enemy attacks with a forward direction movement. But other than that, there's not really a whole lot of depth to this combat. Not that there needs to be, but the best is yet to come. Once you go to the village, you can talk to various NPCs who are preparing for the festival of some sort. This village is so peaceful, adults standing around making preparations for this festival, kids playing around carefree, and there's a creepy cemetery with some mysterious character wearing Native American attire. His name is Frank, and he's apparently an explorer. Perhaps he's important later in the game, but for now, he loses some demon. To progress on further, we have to help the townsfolk by backtracking to the mountains to get things like wood for the barbecue fire and flowers because an old lady wants flowers. But when we finally see the chief after doing all those chores, we finally learn why he's not out there doing the things he wants. The chief won't let him leave the village due to some promise he made with Veyron's parents, who got the unexplained Disney death a long time ago, so I guess it's a dying wish. And if you want to leave the village, you can't because of these guards. So Awaya and Veyron make plans to explore the area beyond the Western Guard, and when everyone's asleep after the party, Veyron escapes and goes through the first dungeon of the game, the Forbidden Cave. Iwaya doesn't accompany you on this, and you're alone trying to do various puzzles, and they're designed similarly to a Legend of Zelda top-down dungeon, where your goal is to explore these dungeons, fight basic enemies, avoid hazardous obstacles, open treasure chests, find keys, and hopefully progress. The music playing in this dungeon really gives off a sense of mystery and somewhat of a fear of the unknown. What is at the end of the dungeon?
I'll give you a hint. Let's see. We have the naive young hero who's desperately in search of adventure. The peaceful village he's confined to is preparing for some festival of some sort, celebrating their hero. But there's also a lot of foreshadowing of some ancient evil. Yeah, this village is screwed.
At the end of this dungeon, there's a stone behind a jar. You can't open this jar, so you investigate the stone. Every time you scratch it, the jar makes a sound with some electricity coming out of it. Eventually, the jar explodes, revealing a demon. I didn't see that coming. He was imprisoned in that jar, and now he's free, like every other demon in an RPG. But this one is different because he has an evil laugh voiced by Stefan Cornicard, the French voice of Dr. Entropy from Crash Bandicoot 3. Fun fact! This is your first boss battle in the game, and Ratheros is pretty easy, and yes, his name is Ratheros. The trick is to avoid his projectile attacks, slash him until his health depletes, and that's all there really is to it. It's very basic and not the best first boss battle I've fought, but it gets the job done. But things take a dark turn, as after the battle, he throws a flame over to you, only for Iwaya to appear and stand in front and take the blast. She professes her love to Veyron and dies. That's pretty dark. And it doesn't help that the demon taunts you and starts destroying the dungeon in which you have to escape, and even though I saw this coming a mile away, the village was destroyed. Usually games that have the village's attack trope just have a few people die, but there have to be survivors just to have some silver lining. But no, you see children die at the hands of demons. You see the corpses of people you knew from the festival. They're all lying dead. And of course, these demons that follow the one you released will be the main bosses you seek out to kill later in the game. It's actually really cool to see what you're up against before encountering them in a battle to the death. And before you leave this village, you see the dying chief who tells you to save yourself. And after you leave the village, you go out to the cave near the beach. But looking at all of what just happened, Veyron had aspirations of becoming an adventurer, but the townsfolk didn't want him wandering in that cave for a reason. That imprisoned demon being that very reason, and now your friend is dead. The village is destroyed. Everyone had to die because of Veyron's curiosity got the better of him, and now it's become this little piece of hell. So Veyron escapes on a raft in kind of a trial and error segment, which if you know me, I really don't like trial and error types of games. There's these cliffs and floating objects you have to avoid, and if you get hit by one, you have to do it all over again. Problem is that you're moving so fast that a cliff or object can just fly in faster than your reaction time would allow. Good thing these escape sequences are rare, but they still kind of suck for this reason. At least games like Battletoads Turbo Tunnel gave you a warning of what's ahead. After that, there's a text scroll describing what happened and what's going to happen. I'm not sure if the developer intended for this, but I kind of see it as a nice tribute to the first Final Fantasy game in a sense. Whereas after you defeat the first boss being Garland, there's a text scroll telling you about the journey ahead. And now Veyron washes up on an island swearing revenge. Your mission? To kill the demons that destroyed your entire village. That is a pretty powerful setup for the rest of the game. It's really dark, but the game does a fine job giving you a good reason why this path of vengeance is justified. So Veyron wakes up on the beach and heads to Impaya Forest for more informations.
Yeah, the translation job isn't the best. More on that later.
This section has you deal with new enemies as well as have you reach the end, only to start back again. This is kind of like the Lost Woods in the Legend of Zelda games, and there are quite a bit of these labyrinthian sections in the game, and this one just has you spend time playing hide and seek with some plant creature that's kind of similar to Skull Kid in Zelda Twilight Princess, and doesn't add much other than giving you a chance to do before going to town, as well as introduce new and more powerful enemies. This could be seen as early padding, just like in similar applications later, but I only spent around less than 10 minutes looking for this plant creature who finally allowed me to access the town. And it's what you expect out of a town in an RPG. Nice people living in a utopian society, usually run by elders, but there's some special character you have to meet that's not in town currently. And it's not an RPG town without a save point at the center or near the entrance and at least one item shop. Now, I'm not knocking this game for using a common trope, because if it works, it works, but at the same time, you can kind of predict what the town's function in the story will be like. They're in danger, and you need to save them from the volcano that so happens to be run by that demon you saw earlier. Because you're a kid, well, technically a teenager, the guard wouldn't let you leave the village, and it seems like a fight is to ensue until a blonde man intervenes and says he'll take you to the chief of the village. The chief doesn't want you to leave for the volcano due to its danger, but of course Veyron retorts rudely, calling him an old man. He does calm down, telling the chief he's from Yadapa, to which the old man becomes more sympathetic to him since they learn of that village's destruction, and he proceeds to explain their inability to cross the forest to take shelter at this time. But with this interaction, Veyron at this point comes off as somewhat unlikable. That's usually a side effect when the protagonist's primary motivation is revenge, but geez, sometimes he comes off as a total jerk, so much so that you might as well play the villain. In a way, you are. Veyron is essentially an anti-hero, where the only reason the player is with him the whole time is because the villain is a lot worse than him. Now, our hero doesn't kill the innocent, and it's a very human reaction to take your frustrations out on people, but this interaction establishes he is not benevolent at all, nor does he need to be. So Veyron, despite shouting that he'll rest when he wants to, crashes as soon as he goes outside, and some weird animal skin wearing figure approaches him.
I just hope MuBoCor isn't bombarded with hate comments from PETA.
We get a character building dream flashback that does give some insight to the relationship between Veyron and the now deceased Awaya. This reveals not only some insight as to who Veyron's lost parents are, but also how much Awaya meant to him. He never seemed to respond nor acknowledge her romantic advances, but he does seem to trust her enough to open up to her about his parents. So that does give some emotional weight to the relationship. But with Veyron waking up, he is told by the innkeeper to go visit the kid that brought you to the inn south of town. Here we fight more monsters as well. Some of these new enemy types can give you status ailments like poison. Should you be poisoned, you'll lose HP until you drink an antidote or just wait it off. While this is really nothing new in the RPG genre, it does add some complexity to the basic sword combat. I don't recall The Legend of Zelda or Star Tropics having this. I mean, they did have potions, but that's about it. And all that did was just recover HP when you were low. None of the enemies gave you status ailments, unlike this game. And the reason this adds some complexity is, do you take the antidote now? What if you don't? Do you want to risk waiting until the poison wears off? Things like this make the situation more dire and makes you feel more vulnerable, especially in the later dungeons when you have to rely heavily on your health and antidote items. And finally, we reach this cave, and this is where we meet this kid who is the king of the secret society, even though he's referred to as Her Majesty. It might be due to the translation, nor does it really matter in the grand scheme of things, but for the rest of this review, I will refer to Selfie with male pronouns, since more often than not, Selfie is referred to as such. He has four kids serving under him, and it's kind of adorable seeing this secret society of kids reacting to the dire situation in the only way they can. These kids want to help their king protect the village, but the dialogue can lead to some hilarious exchanges, like how the girl always states the obvious, only to be told to shut up by one of the others. But due to them being kids, they react to the situation childishly. To this, protecting the village is just a game to them. And should you take out the fire golem, the king would give you a boat to travel to the next part of the game. Selfie himself, being the most mature of the group, talks about seeing the fire golem and wants to use Veyron as a mercenary for taking it out, and gives you some food item meant to send that guard to sleep. With that out of the way, you enter the volcano, which is the second dungeon in the game, and to say it's hot is no exaggeration. There's a thermometer on the top right of the screen emphasizing how heat plays a huge part in this dungeon. Because if the mercury of the thermometer gets too high, you would pass out and be dragged out into a nearby forest by Selfie himself, who gives you a ton of water after chastising you for your foolishness. The heat will still be a time-based obstacle, but there's always enough water in the dungeon to drink, just so the mercury can be lowered. Warning, the fire-based enemies are prevalent throughout this dungeon. Trust me when I say you do not want to be burned, otherwise you'll have to use water to heal yourself of burn damage. But you also need that water to take out flame obstacles as well as keep yourself hydrated. It's not until you fight a mini-boss that the thermometer is eliminated. This boss is harder than the previous one, but again, it's just a monster spamming attacks and health items while avoiding its dividing smoke attack. That's all there really is to it. And then the second half of the dungeon just involves mainly obstacles with a grappling hook.
Someone's calling in the middle of a review. How convenient. I better answer. Hello? Interesting. Yeah, I'll be sure to tell them. But if you don't mind, you're kind of interrupting a review. Yeah, I'll talk to you later. Bye. Sorry about that. The Legend of Zelda: A Link to the Past just called. They want their hookshot back.
Okay, that's not entirely fair. Yes, it has similar functions like in A Link to the Past, but unlike Zelda's hookshot, the grappling hook only seems to attach to certain types of rocks. No treasure chest, no wood panels, just rocks. And while this tool doesn't blow my mind nor increases the fun factor, it does serve more as a key to progressing further into the dungeon, but the second half is still mostly puzzle solving, unlocking needle gates, and that fun stuff. And finally, we get to the boss we've been waiting for, Garmalava. And he's actually a pretty fun boss to fight, because after he taunts you, the battle begins, and he has a variety of attack banners, from the barrage of flames from afar to the combat up close where you finally have the opportunity to attack him multiple times with your sword. He even has a line of fire that you can only avoid by going atop the central pillar, but there's some sound that gets faster and faster, implying something bomb-like is about to go off. So it's not like you're not warned ahead of time of this attack. And after his defeat, he of course begs for mercy, but we all know that's not going to happen. Can I just say how extremely satisfying it is just for Veyron to end him with an energetic V above him?
Alright, I'll be sure to tell them, okay? Goodbye. Yeah, that was Alan Moore. He wants his vengeful character whose symbol is a V back.
Satisfying victory aside, we embark on yet another escape sequence. This one really sucks because not only do you have to memorize where the falling rocks land on, these red guys move randomly and you basically have to pay attention to the right side of the screen and hoping your character moves in the direction you want. Yes, these sections are short and thankfully this is the last of them, but geez, these can take many tries just to get right and rely solely on memorization. With that out of the way, Impaya is saved. The town thanks you, promising you a ship will appear tomorrow. Return to Selphie and he gives you a fire sword that wasn't exactly acquired in the most honest way.
But it's not like anyone is using it at the moment, given how you're the only one who's challenging the demon and his armies. Seriously, where are all the knights and armies going against him? You're like the only one who dares oppose his forces.
The next day, you depart on boat, get some sleep on the boat, and it gets attacked by sea creatures. Some people are lying dead, while others are shaken up a bit.
That's gotta be coincidence, come on. You know what, I'll just tell them, bye. Shining Force just called.
After you defeat them, the ship is so badly damaged that they have to drop you off somewhere close by. You're back at the overworld and head for some colorless looking trees. There you meet a coughing purple man who fires an arrow at you. Wow, things escalated quickly. He's apparently a blacksmith that was the victim of some Lovecraftian monstrosity he tried to finish off. But to cure the old man of his illness, you have to kill the creature and let the old man drink its blood. Thankfully, he gives us a bow and arrow he forged, which is only temporary, but it's pretty nice. This section is a really nice way to break up the pace of the game. There comes a point where simple combat with a sword with grid-like movement can only be interesting for so long. One way to keep things interesting is to introduce a new playstyle consistent with this type of movement. This is where Veyron sidesteps and takes out enemies with a bow, and it's incredibly fun. But fighting off those enemies, and especially that Lovecraftian creature in a fast-paced boss battle, dodging its many projectiles with the sidestepping, and finishing it off, that was quite exciting. With Veyron giving the old man the creature's blood, this was definitely a memorable section of the game. With Veyron giving the old man the creature's blood, he alludes to how Veyron reminds him of a friend who practiced red magic. Well, whatever that is. He's also the first character we come across that looks at Veyron for what he is, citing how his look is demonic and how he has a bad feeling something a lot worse is going to happen. That is really uncomfortable and keeps the player wondering whether we really are playing as the good guy or good enough guy. Anyways, with you out of the forest, you have the opportunity to do a few side quests in this area, or you can just continue on with your main quest. The next path in the main quest would be this cave to the north, which has a really desolate beauty to it. From the melancholy music to the dripping sound effects of the water, it's quite a magical place. Here's where we'll meet the Mubos, that the devs use as their company symbol. They are interesting little creatures that are quite intelligent, but one of them stole Veyron's weapons, so the first encounter isn't exactly the most friendly. This section of the game confused me since you only activate the scenario by interacting with a rock blocking the exit, just so the Mubo could steal your swords. I would have preferred if the creature just did that as soon as you step into the intersection, but regardless, you follow it and meet the chief of these creatures, who was standing in front of the sword thief. Apparently they're a telepathic species, as they amusingly respond to Veyron's hunger for these creatures that he's thinking to himself, but they discuss the ogre that threatens their civilization and will give you your swords back in addition to their special bombs known as clackabooms.
Oh cool, I can't wait to try them out!
But you gotta catch 5 fireflies in an area north to the village because they need energy and they don't want to be spotted by the ogre by collecting these fireflies. With that out of the way, we can finally bomb some rocks, leave the village, return to the surface of the cave, where there are now these deadly explosive enemies as well as a subspecies that has lightning. These enemies can shave off a lot of health if you're not careful, but it's a welcome addition because it keeps the combat interesting in between the various puzzles you do. Although, I got stuck in this one puzzle only because it took forever for me to figure out that my grappling devices needed to hit these wall switches. Nothing in the game told me this except how different this specific part of the wall looked. I do like the inclusion of these bomb switches that require you to throw an ignited bomb on the other side of the needles, giving variety to these types of find the switch puzzles. Except, unlike the first and second dungeons, it's not about simply just moving rocks around or using the grappling hook. And after the game taught us how to use the bombs with these various puzzles, we finally reach the ogre, after Veyron awakens it with a bomb. Finally, he fights it with the bombs you provided. I died several times on this boss battle, only because I let myself get surrounded by my own bombs and the ogre's bombs, and let me tell you, they pack a punch. It's kind of annoying having to watch the chase sequence play out multiple times every time you respawn, but the battle itself is pretty fun if you know what you're doing. Definitely not the best designed boss battle in the game, and kind of a downgrade in comparison to the last one, but it's a boss battle that challenges your skills with the bombs, and for that, it's quite serviceable. Of course, the chief takes all the credit after the ogre is defeated, but the Mubo are saved and we finally can move on to the desert where things get heated.
So much for dad jokes.
But seriously, when you go to the northeastern town, it seems abandoned until you see a group of people and an orc, with the orc demanding that a man and a boy surrender to him. Apparently these orcs have been enslaving this area, and with Veyron intervening, we now have to eliminate all of the orcs in town. This part of the game really shows how much of an impact Rathalos' generals had on the world. From volcanoes about to erupt to poison forests, to even slavery becoming an issue for some people. The world has quickly descended into chaos, but luckily we're informed that the leader of these orcs is somewhere in the desert. Once they're eliminated and the water supply is restored, Veyron is given a desert bow. It functions similar to the blacksmith's bow, except without the infinite ammo. It's useful for reaching switches and taking out faraway enemies, but because they're limited ammo, you don't want to use the arrows too much, otherwise you might have to spend a few minutes entering and exiting a screen, hoping a defeated enemy would drop 5 arrows. The game teaches you how to use the bow immediately thanks to the orc on the bridge. You can't cross it unless you take it out with a bow and arrow. That is pretty clever, and the tutorial doesn't end there as you can't access the closed doors at the dead end unless you hit the switch above it that only an arrow could reach. There's no intrusive menu stating the obvious, but instead, your observational skills would show you the possibilities of this new ability. So you go down the elevator and leave that area. You basically are back at the overworld, but have to find where to go next. The only complication with this section is that you might have to grind for bombs since they're needed to blow up rocks blocking the entrance to a mountain you need to access. The problem is, there's various mountains that are blocked off by boulders, and 2 orcs that need to be taken out. These are guarding the slaves, and after taking them out, one of them tells tells you how to access a secret passage at the Oasis, leading to the next dungeon, after a few tries, of course. There's the usual switch puzzles, with the ending puzzle being one of those 9 switch puzzles that have the surrounding switches do the opposite of their current position, and the goal is to have them all pressed downwards. I was never good at these types of puzzles, so depending on the player, he could spend a few minutes or 10 minutes doing this. But with that out of the way, we finally reached the tower, and this dungeon is probably my favorite in the game because even though there's your standard find the switch puzzles, this dungeon feels like you're making progress every second with its more combat-oriented focus and faster pace. Many of the rooms have a staircase and even balcony exits showing you how high you are in the tower. You know the King of Orcs who helped destroy your village is up there, and you're just slicing and dicing and bombing any obstacle in your way to get up there. Because of the previous dungeons and even that section before the tower, giving you all those puzzles with the switches and needle gates, you've come to expect that the rest of the game would be like that, but this tower, while I wouldn't want this design mentality for more than one dungeon, it makes sense given the context and as a result feels like an exhilarating experience. Especially with that triumphant theme playing in the background, it sets the mood perfectly for what is to come. It's not like there's no complex puzzles to be had, as they introduce a collect the wood to light the torches kind of puzzle here, as well as slide the orb switches to the corresponding color buttons, so it never feels like mindless puzzles are put throughout this dungeon. And finally, you're in the throne room. But there's no one there, so of course bomb the pillar and save your game, because why not? Here is probably my favorite sequence in the story. You expect to have a long boss battle against this magic-using orc, but Faerun, being the reckless Avenger he is, tries to kill him and gets stuck in the Star of David pentagram. And the orc goes in his mind. This is where you actually play as the orc, which may sound like a strange scenario due to being conditioned by the game to want his life to end, but this is the opportunity the game gives to the player to really learn who we truly are playing as. This is all the disturbing things hidden from us in Veyron's subconscious, and things get really intense. We wander around the island seeing memories of Veyron doing things from reacting to Uwaya and the Chief, except this orc can actually see things even Veyron didn't see. Like how the Chief mentions how he can't tell Veyron the truth about his father or his long-lost brother. Then the village starts on fire like in the attack, every corpse is in place, and some really creepy organ music starts playing. So we head up north just to see some cult group gathered with a hooded figure at the bottom, with the orc questioning the link between the hooded figure and Veyron, as if he knows the character, yet we don't. The cult members disappear when you try to interact with them, and you have to unlight the torches, and when the room is dark, they illuminate again, and now we're at the source of evil. This is getting really creepy as we're seeing the place in Veyron's mind that we haven't visited, and now we see that needle from earlier in the game with a purple flame emitting from it. And to make this all the more unsettling, the orc mentions how we might be in the part of Veyron's mind that represents the future, and from the looks of it, it doesn't look good. Especially since the sword itself tells us to leave, but the orc can't. We're trapped in the really screwed up mind of Veyron. From a quick time sequence initiating the orc's lightning to a now shadowy versions of Veyron appearing in his own mind. This is the boss battle. You play as the orc fighting against these shadowy apparitions of Veyron. You think you're going in to fight the orc just to put another mark on the vengeance checklist, but no. You're now playing as the monster you thought you were going to fight, trying to keep him alive from the materialized Veyrons attacking you. This is how you play with player expectations. It not only serves as an excellent setup for a boss battle, but it also enhances this revenge narrative. You so far were given nothing but in-game validation as to how you're in the right for seeking vengeance against these evil creatures. But with the exception of a few dialogue exchanges from NPCs, you were never given any reason to believe that this quest could have a negative impact. And now we're seeing that this is more than just a simple vendetta. This is outright corruption of the character. This sentient dark sword, as established in the mind travel sequence, is giving Veyron some unnatural powers, like Veyron being able to materialize in his own mind. This is outright terrifying because the quest has a whole new meaning. These shadowy figures even form into one powerful enemy known as Demoniac Veyron, implying that there's some evil going on in Veyron's mind, furthering how corrupt he's become. Although thanks to the orc's magical powers, this boss battle is pretty easy because you have a lot of magic on your side, like the screen nuking lightning and the long range flames, but it's still nonetheless an entertaining boss battle that helps move the story forward. And the mind travel sequence ends with the laughter of oddly his master Ratheros, and as soon as he he's back in reality, he justifiably calls Veyron a monster before Veyron just throws him off the top of the tower. So with the orc off the vengeance checklist, you can head back to the northeastern town to learn of giant birds who are swarming one of the mountains. So you go to one of those mountains, ride one of those giant birds in kind of a clunky space shooter type minigame. I mean, it's fine that the bird moves left and right, but the only way to fire is by pressing the forward arrow key, which sucks because it doesn't feel natural. Like, why couldn't the F key be the fire key? I can only imagine what gamepad users have to go through in this section. Regardless, after shooting your way through these little gargoyles, there's a giant gargoyle boss battle that you can somehow rapid fire arrows at, and there's not much to this boss battle other than avoid the flames. Even though I welcome a change in gameplay for variety's sake, I do think sometimes it works and sometimes it doesn't in this game, and this is one of the times it doesn't work as well as I would like. After that section of the game, Veyron lands in an icy part of the world where we now enter a snow-covered forest with no village in sight. So you cross the forest and it has a pleasant winter atmosphere with really detailed snowflakes slowly moving around on screen. There are enemies populating the area, with one even shooting magic arrows, and this section will introduce an ice floor puzzle where you can only slide in one direction until you hit a solid object. It's pretty basic, but it is just to introduce you to this type of puzzle since it will appear in the ice dungeon later. And we finally arrive at the village where the villagers look like they're freezing to death. This is a new settlement since their old village was attacked and several people even died. Right now, they're starving to death, with some people either sick or injured, or both. You see, with the previous two towns, one was about to be attacked and one was attacked. This village has been attacked and suffered heavy losses before your arrival. There was no hero to save them from their pain. And it turns out that the snake woman we saw earlier in the game was responsible for their hard times. One guy even lost his two children to her, with his wife so distraught that she won't even speak anymore. That is so depressing. The chief, like all the other chiefs, tells you where to find the snake, and so you head down there, fight various enemies on the way until you come across the old village, and already you can see how bad these people really have it. Jeez, I think this demon of all the subordinates of Rathoros, this one needs to die the most. Not only did she help destroy your village and kill your people, but she did the same to another village. So you finally meet her and she's sadistically bored due to no one to massacre, and of course a boss battle ensues. Now she launches ice-based attacks, and it's much like that lava monster you fought in the volcano where she just launches projectiles until you eventually battle her on solid ground. And of course she's a mini boss, so she's not too difficult, as it just amounts to cornering her, spamming sword attacks, and deflecting any ice attacks. It's all fairly standard. But of course, she freezes you solid and escapes, so you will fight her again at the end of the dungeon she resides in, but as she's about to shatter you, a person wearing a bear suit steps in and teleports you out.
Guess who?
Turns out it's Selphy, and now he's sporting a white polar bear skin this time.
PETA is really going to have a field day with this game.
He's back, and he actually gives you more insight onto your impact of your journey, on how Veyron is a one-man show, having no allies, tagging along, walking in a straight line. Wow, this game is pretty self-aware. But more importantly, on how they speak more of a bloodthirsty man than they do the demons. Jeez, it's not like Veyron killed anyone innocent, but it just goes to show how much of an effect that quest for vengeance can have on people. And of course, Veyron walks away angrily and continues onward to some treacherous mountain filled with these ice turtle enemies that can really pack a punch with those ice projectiles. You do not want to get hit by them if you want to keep your HP. But of course, Selphy follows you and gives you a fire wand needed to melt ice-based obstacles, which can really come in handy, especially for puzzles that involve lighting torches that are just up ahead, in addition to being the only weapon those ice turtles are vulnerable to. And we're finally at the ice dungeon. This combines everything from those ice turtles to the slippery ice-based puzzles earlier, but this dungeon has a section where there are 4 MacGuffins needed to open a gate, and it is rather time-consuming, but this dungeon is pretty fresh thanks to the added challenge of the slippery ice, and the two-phase rematch with Medulla doesn't disappoint either. She first makes an ice platform for herself, launching the usual ice projectiles, and you can either use bombs against her, or you can use the flame wand you got from Selphy. The second phase has her off that platform, but because she's invulnerable, you need to light all the torches in the room to make her no longer invincible, due to the heat of that room exhausting her since she's an ice-based creature. Each time this happens, you can spam sword attacks, draining away her health until the flames go out, and then she's he's invincible again, so you have to light them again. This is no doubt the best boss battle in the game because of this. Not only does the fight change and get more interesting, but there's some core objective and reward for doing said objective. So you can easily extinguish the flames with her projectiles before you light all of them, so you have to be mindful of where her attacks go. With her defeated thanks to Celephi distracting her, he informs us of an airship from Ferolum sent to help the surviving villagers and relocate them to their city. We of course board the ship and we're taken to the city. Problem is, we need to reach the last demon being the one we released at the beginning to end this quest for vengeance once and for all. With that said, we head to the mayor of Ferolum and he refuses to let us have the airship. It doesn't help that he knows Veyron wouldn't tell him what he needs it for, but regardless, we have to find an alternate way into the hangar so we can steal the airship. To which the homeless man will tell us how in exchange for money, and we find ourselves in an enemy infested area and puzzles involving, you guessed it, more switches. Eventually, we reach the hangar after all of those challenges and we board the airship. Here we encounter a sick girl who's unconscious and her senile father, who attacks you until you defeat him. He introduces himself as Mado, the owner of the airship. Also, his daughter Selena is the airship's engineer because she's apparently a prodigy.
A child and a lunatic run this ship. The ship that so happens to be thousands of miles up in the sky. I don't know if it's just me, but I would not want to be a passenger in that ship.
She fell ill after being attacked by a flying monster, but of all the characters we've met, Mado is my least favorite because of how annoying he can be. I get that he's insane and all, but making an insane character is a double-edged sword. You can have either a comic relief character, a character who puts his insanity to good use, or a character who can be a hindrance thanks to the insanity. Unfortunately, other than eventually gaining the ability to ride the airship where you want, and even getting the quest essential hammer for your troubles, he falls into the latter category and doesn't do much to add to the lore of the game. I don't hate him, but I don't love him either for this reason, especially with how he explains things not in a chronological order, making it more confusing if anything. I suppose that's supposed to be the point, but if that was done for humor's sake, it didn't really get a laugh out of me. So despite being close to the end, we have to do two more dungeons to first get the hammer and then get the ore needed to cure his daughter. And to be honest, this feels like padding and doesn't really do much to the world building of the game, as it's nothing we haven't seen before. Don't get me wrong, the journey to the first one had an amazing sight to behold in the darkened sunset area, with a pleasant yet melancholy music piece to go alongside it, but the destination itself is just a test of everything you know. More puzzles requiring a lot of the tools such as bombs, fire staff, and arrows, just to lower the needle gates, nothing new or exhilarating. Even the boss is underwhelming. All it has you do is just throw your own bombs at him or throw back his bombs. It's basically a dumbed down version of the ogre battle, except with even less consequence. The next dungeon is better because you actually have the new hammer ability with puzzles designed around that. Although, like the previous dungeon, the boss is also disappointing since you can just corner it and suck out all of its HP with spammed hammer attacks. But regardless, we have the ore. So now, Veyron and Mado have to go meet someone that can turn the ore into the cure his daughter needs. This area is one of those labyrinthian forest mazes and doesn't provide a whole lot we haven't seen before with the previous one. But eventually we come across a Mubo who at first is afraid of us thanks to Mado yelling at her and has the gall to say Veyron let her go and didn't go with a plan that he didn't tell us about. It's kind of surprising Veyron of all people had to tell him to approach it peacefully, to which Mado asks why he would help a bandit like you. He is really getting on my nerves. We finally catch up to the Mubo and with magic, I guess. She turns the ore soft into some candy that would be edible. Selena seems to respond well to it, and Mado thanks us, but we can't pilot the airship until he checks everything out before liftoff, so we might as well sleep. There's gonna be a dream sequence flashback, isn't there?
Sure is. What can I say? I'm a fortune teller. Just like how I know your fortune, you will subscribe. Please do. I'm desperate.
And this is where we see Veyron on a hilltop as Awaya descends from the sky, dancing around and singing some song about Veyron that's in French, but I think the visuals do a fine enough job communicating the idea it's going for. Veyron attempts to embrace Awaya, but phases through her apparition every attempt. He may have been annoyed by her as established in the previous cutscenes, but here we can see she really meant something to him. Whether it be as a good friend or even a love interest, it doesn't matter. It works either way, and despite me not knowing the French lyrics, The song is beautiful. It perfectly captures the moment, and I really wouldn't want an English dub of the song because it might ruin the rhythm. If MuboCore really wanted to, they could add English text to accompany each stanza of the song, but I don't think it's necessary since the visuals alone give you all you need to know. And at the end, she gives us a hint of where we need to go, where it all started. Home. Yadapa Village. And with full control over the ship, we can finally fly to the ruins of Yadapa and find out its biggest secret, one the villagers hid so well. Under the statue of their savior, there is a tunnel that leads to a rock-filled chamber with the sword we saw in Veyron's mind, the one that probably manipulated Veyron into coming here in the first place. With Veyron acquiring it, we are ready for the challenge ahead. We are ready to face Rathoros and end him once and for all. The camera pans upwards on the overworld map, revealing the island of Rathoros, and Maida warns us about the sword we acquired, but of course Veyron is impatient, asking him to use the ship to go to the island. Reluctantly, Maida agrees, and the end is near. But the question is, you have the freedom to explore the world, even do side quests previously inaccessible. Do you do those first to make the final dungeon easier for yourself, or do you go straight for the castle? It's all up to you. And I really like the freedom this game gives you for that reason. For the sake of story, I headed over there and now we're at the final area of the game. After taking out the barrier with their sentient sword, we're in a dark and gloomy forest very similar to Skull Woods in A Link to the Past, with gigantic rib cages and dead trees all around these woods. Maida, despite being a raving lunatic as established before, gives us one last warning with Veyron brushing it off. And let me tell you, this place nails the final area of the game. It contains really powerful enemies, giving you only a sample of the storm ahead. And finally, we're at the castle gates, and inside the castle is the final dungeon in the game. While I did say the Desert Tower was my favorite dungeon in the game, this is probably the best designed dungeon in the game because of how many choices you have to go about your progression. Similar to the Ice Dungeon, you have to fulfill several objectives to open the gate, but how you go about them is up to you. There are several mini-bosses that, when defeated, will light up one of the four unlit torches in the entryway, and these mini-bosses are no pushover. Bosses like the Slime Wall that have distinct enough attack patterns that you know when it's best to go up to it and spam sword attacks, but should you attack it too early, it will fight back and might throw you into the flames should you attack too early, which would result in burn damage. Although the mini-boss battle with death itself was confusing at first, there wasn't much context as to how to defeat it, as it's invulnerable to your sword. I only came across the solution by accident, but you have to light the torches in a certain order just to kill it. You can't just light them all and it will happen. Should you make a mistake where the flames are blue, there is a water dispenser to put the flames out, but I still would have liked some hint or context as to how to defeat this boss, like maybe a panel saying an order like, "The sun rises in the east, upwards it shines, until it sets in the west." Something so seemingly nonsensical but gives enough context as to what to do will make the player be like, "Aha, I know what to do." Mind you, this isn't the correct order, but that's an example of how to send the player in the right direction without telling them the answer directly. But that's about the only thing questionable in this dungeon. It's a long dungeon that took me 2 hours to beat, no thanks to the return of that button puzzle that I'm just no good at. And with this dungeon requiring the use of all of your tools, I feel like that sense of incoming finality was present throughout this entire dungeon. There was always something to do, there were always treasure chests giving you a few items so you don't have to farm for them, and there's plenty of save points to save at. And finally, the red carpeting leads into the room where Rathoros awaits you after the gate is opened. He questions how you got there, but with Veyron displaying his anger, he laughs until realizing you have the sword he once owned. With Veyron taunting him, Rathoros integrates a seemingly alive and well Iwaya. She asks him to come closer, taking advantage of Veyron's sudden shock and lapse in judgment, only for him to discover it's not her, at least not how he remembered her. What we have here is a zombified pyrokinetic Iwaya, exclaiming how he left her to die, and with Veyron enraged, a really tough battle ensues, but eventually she's defeated, with her saying how she dies yet again in your arms. But in an awesome still image, he kisses her and stabs her with the sword. That is awesome. Gory, but awesome. Even Rathoros is speechless. In fact, he appears terrified at what Veyron is capable of, feeling all the more of a need to kill him. So the second battle ensues, and he's even harder due to his pentagram, electric attacks, blue projectiles, and even black hole bombs. The trick is to avoid this, which is easier said than done with a four-directional movement, but definitely not impossible. With his second phase over with, Veyron gloats about how Rathoros isn't strong enough, to which Rathoros mentions he'll be the second person to make that mistake. Is he talking about that savior back at the village? It's never really explained, but more implied. Regardless, Rathoros transforms into a four-armed demon with wings and teleports out of there. Cross a pentagram teleported into a room with a save point and some treasure chests with healing items, and the final battle begins. And it's quite climactic, as he'll do a variation of the attacks done previously until the gate is lowered, giving you the opportunity to strike him, and he even needs to recover after a barrage of black hole attacks, giving you time to strike him several times. While boss battles are definitely not this game's strong suit, this one doesn't disappoint and is a worthy last challenge before the game ends. And with Rathoros getting his last slashes before being destroyed, Veyron got his revenge. This is the moment the game built up to. Veyron started this adventure as a naive kid who wants to go out in search of adventure, but at the cost of his loved ones and sense of morality did he get that. From helping people in need and taking out these monsters once and for all, making this world a better place, nothing will ever be able to undo the good Veyron has done in his quest for vengeance, right?
Not exactly.
Veyron has accomplished these goals, but not from the moral high ground. In fact, his primary motivation is revenge, as previously established, and in many world religions, wrath is a sin. The game isn't called Veyron's Wrath for nothing, so as Veyron approaches the throne that Rathoros once occupied, the purple tendrils transform him, giving him a white hair dye job, and he now swears vengeance against the world. What? Selphie appears at the castle gate exclaiming that it's too late. Mado senses that Veyron has turned evil. The old man at the forest senses the maleficent energy from Veyron, and some hooded figure that looks like a Jawa from Star Wars we were given no introduction to before reacts negatively to this, and the credits roll.
Wait, that's it? What the f-
This ending is a mixed bag for me. On one hand, the characters warned us that we were going down a dark path on this quest for vengeance. The old man, Selephie, and Mado were the ones who were the most honest about it in this adventure, and it didn't help that Veyron grabbed an evil sword, but at the same time, more could have been done to make this ending better. I would have liked a dark sword to speak to Veyron throughout this ordeal, like telling him to kill Rathoros and maybe convince Veyron that the world needs a leader to rule it with an iron fist. I would have liked the people in the various towns to be terrified at what's to come, have some dark energy illuminate from the island as they watch from afar, have the credits roll, and then have a still of Veyron sitting on his throne with the sword to the side doing a demonic laugh similar to that of Rathoros, except a little more distorted. That would have worked, giving the player a reason to feel this was earned, even if it was from a morally questionable point of view. But as it is, it's a little disappointing and feels somewhat of a setup for a sequel, which is fine and all, but if the player is to spend 15 hours on this quest, the ending should at least serve as an ending chapter to a lengthy novel. But even that is not the biggest flaw of the story. We're given some backstory, but it's never really answered, but instead foreshadowed to be revealed later in the game. Except it's not revealed, and we have to wait for a sequel in order to get some information. Like, who are Veyron's parents? Who is Veyron's long-lost brother? And who is that hooded figure? Who was Selphie's father? Is Selphie the long-lost brother? There's a lot of implications, but it doesn't get answered at all, lessening Veyron's sense of purpose. I wouldn't mind it that much if the game didn't constantly remind us of this information that's unanswered. Because what if Veyron discovered who his brother was? Would he rethink his quest? That would have been interesting. Heck, it doesn't even have to be revealed to Veyron, but to the audience in a post-credits scene. Maybe the hooded figure could be Veyron's estranged brother, mentioning the family's history of evil. There's just so many missed opportunities with this ending. I don't hate it at all, but I just don't love it and think more should have been done.
But at least the side quests add to the game length.
Oh yes, if the main campaign was fine until that mixed bag of an ending, the side quests I'm happy to say will definitely give you your money's worth. The first one you can do is where you wander into a camp, reuniting with Frank, and we learn about how they were attacked by orcs. Frank joins us in infiltrating the orc castle, to which we don an orc disguise. Eventually we're found out and imprisoned until Frank breaks us out, and we engage in a pretty fun stealth slash puzzle sequence where each character can switch from one to the other.
The Legend of Zelda Majora's Mask just called. You know what? Never mind.
And that battle against the orcs in the gladiator-style arena was quite fun, especially when Veyron takes them all out before going unconscious. Frank thanks us for saving his village and gives us life nuts that permanently extends max HP. Not a bad reward for a unique side quest. There's also a few side quests involving you helping people of this harbor take out loose wild animals in the overworld, from the vicious tiger to the cowardly wolf and, aw, jeez, a gorilla.
This is going to be an homage to Donkey Kong, isn't it?
It kind of is, but not really. You just have to climb things and avoid projectiles before it jumps off the top of the mountain committing suicide. It's probably from hypoxia being that high up on the mountain and all. There's a few side quests you can do in the gnar whatever you call it, but these are a now or never type side quests, and because I clearly had medicinal herbs yet this girl said I don't have them, I didn't do any of these side quests for them and just continued on with my main quest. There's a few involving you using a lot of bombs or arrows, something like that, and you're rewarded for it if you find those people in the caves. It's a neat way to incentivize exploration of the overworld, as you never know who you'll meet in the caves until you do. But the one that really stands out, besides the Orc Fortress, is the 100 Bugs Killed side quest, where a peculiar old man tells you how many insects you killed and asks you not to do it or something terrible will happen.
Challenge accepted.
With that being said, I kill 100 insects in Selphie's abandoned cave, going in and out so they respawn so I can kill more. And when I got to the Insect Man's cave after killing 100, a giant insect appears and is really mad. It's actually harder than Rathuros, and really, I recommend stocking up on health items before engaging in this fight. It's relentless with its projectiles and tornado attacks. After it's killed, Veyron vows not to kill any more insects, and the old man, despite you being a horrible person in his eyes, gives you a travel bag. Still didn't stop me from killing more insects. And then there's the temple side quest, where an island in the southeast of the overworld has a village that speaks of a dangerous temple and some are preparing to evacuate. When we go there, we find two tiki masked fellows surrounded by four pedestals with four different colored stones, but the left tiki makes them disappear and is subsequently chastised by his comrade before they both fall into the holes in the floor. So we go back to the village and tell the chief, and she suggests we go to places in the world that the stones were originally from, but this means backtracking to the fire, ice, and desert dungeons. But this time, the dungeons are populated with tiki enemies we have to fight and eventually find the three stones. When we return to the temple, the fourth stone, being the black one, just reappears. That's odd. But with the gate now open since the stones are placed back onto their pedestals, we proceed through this temple filled with the tiki enemies and various puzzles, and then we fight a boss battle against their monstrosities, which again hit like a tank, but once defeated, our sword is twice as powerful as it once was, making really short work of the final boss if you use it against him. This one and the Orc Fortress I'd say are the side quests that have a decent enough adventure and adequate rewards to go with. The other smaller ones I didn't even bother with personally, while the side quest that's basically like the Cave of Ordeals in Zelda Twilight Princess, I was never able to get 100 points thanks to this ice turtle. Yeah, if you take damage, you lose some points, and you need 100, which is a perfectionist run in these 10 stages of this cave. So I never found out what was in that chest, unfortunately. From my knowledge, none of the side quests improve the ending and just make getting there easier, which is fine enough for a side questian like myself.
And that's Veyron's Wrath, a unique RPG that's definitely worth $15.
The story of the game is decent, with it having a strong beginning, good middle, and mixed conclusion, but it's probably better in French because I came across some weird translation dialogue boxes that, while they get the point across, it does take away the immersion a little bit. You could justify it by saying that's how they talk in Veyron's world, but it's still a bit jarring. Heck, on the rare occasion, some text boxes were left untranslated. I wouldn't say it's a sign of laziness at all, because translating is difficult for a dialogue-heavy RPG, and there will be some oversight. Mubo Core has made some updates, which somewhat alleviated this issue, but it is pretty noticeable in some sections. The puzzles are quite standard, giving you many opportunities to use your acquired items in the dungeons, but sometimes puzzles involving switches can go on for a little bit too long. I do like how it places emphasis on exploration and observation like an action RPG should incentivize, and the combat is simple, but I feel like more could have been done at the same time. There were only three swords I came across and wonder why there weren't more. That could have made for some interesting combat scenarios. For an action RPG, I also think it would benefit from having an experience system, given how enemies have HP type health bars and you see numbers rolling as the enemies is being hit. That would add some complexity to the combat. I understand it takes inspiration from Newtopia and Star Tropics, but even in those games the combat was serviceable at best. Just simply using a sword and other items is fine, but that's it. Luckily, when a sequel is made, there would be an opportunity to add something we haven't quite seen with the combat, maybe a combo system or even an experience system. Heck, why not both? Why not even implement an armor system? Heck, maybe even abandon the four-directional movement altogether and go for something more fluid akin to Link's Awakening's movement and combat. That would give more freedom as to how to design a really good boss battle and combat situations with different types of enemies. The only technical flaw of the game I've seen would probably be how the frame rate can chug sometimes. It's not like my computer can't run a game like this because it was made in RPG Maker, and my computer far surpasses the recommended specs, so it's not a deal breaker at all, but it would raise some eyebrows when the text forms letters here and there instantly rather than progressively form them in a smooth way. But with that negative aside, I must say I love the visuals of the game. So much passion went into immersing the player, from the lighting effects of the beach to the illumination of torches in dark areas, to even things like that dark grassy area in the sunset. Even the dungeons occasionally had some neat visuals, like the scary demon statues in the final castle. They're so unsettling that they look like they could come to life any moment and attack me. And the soundtrack is by far the strongest aspect of the game. I don't recall one time where the music was off cue. From the themes of the current situation in a town to when a certain character is present, everything is done so well with tracks such as How's the World Out There, that goes well with Veyron's desire for the adventure out there, to the melancholy Mewbo's Cave theme that just makes you feel lost and cut off from civilization in this dark and mysterious cave. The organ percussion in the Disturbed Mind theme just has that satanic presence that it's going for. A piece of Veyron's personal hell that is his mind that dare not be explored by anyone else, that really supports the bit of exposition it's going for. Most of the game's soundtrack was composed by Romain Favre, and his pieces are so amazing. I highly recommend aspiring indie devs to seek him out and hire him if they need music of this genre. He's only 18 and already is better than 90% of video game music composers out there. But I also said he composed most of this game's soundtrack because one of this game's advertised features on Steam was the two music pieces composed by the Josh Mansell, famous for Crash Bandicoot Trilogy and Crash Team Racing, as well as the Jak and Daxter games. What are these pieces, you may ask? Well, I've been carefully listening to this game's soundtrack, and it's actually for a side quest. It's a welcome guest composition, because the Crash and Daxter games always had themes consistent with that of ancient ruins, and because the temple is that of some mysterious civilization, the themes he composed work very well. It's great seeing him return to the gaming scene, even if it is just for two music pieces. With all of this being said, Veyron's Wrath is definitely a project of passion. It wasn't designed out of the desires of focus groups, but instead genuine passion of a few people who wanted to make a game.
With all of this being said in this really long video, I'd say that Veyron's Wrath is definitely pretty good.
Like all games, it isn't perfect, but neither was the first Final Fantasy, neither was The Legend of Zelda, neither was Dragon Quest I. Although, given how this was made in RPG Maker in this day and age, this game is a lot more fun than those games. I just want to illustrate how much potential this could be for a series. We have an ending that's open for a sequel, and hopefully that sequel will come in a few years because I want to see the next chapter of this world. Would it tell the tale of how the land reacted to Veyron's actions years after the game? Would it take place in the distant future of the next person who gets the Dark Sword? Only time will tell. Mewbo Corps is currently making a beat-em-up style game called Wolf's Fury, which I hope does well, and it is slated for a 2017 release. Romain Favre is returning to make music for that, and the game even has those gelatinous enemies from Veyron's Wrath, so I'm guessing that's a Mewbo Corps symbol. While I'm not a fan of beat-em-up style games, there's quite the audience for them out there, and I wish them the best. I may purchase it for myself when it comes out, given how I am confident in their abilities to make a game, but as for Veyron's next adventure, only time will tell before we see what's next for this fantasy world. We may have to wait a little bit, but a video game sequel is also a dish best served cold.
But until then, I have plenty of games to play and review. Thank y'all so much for watching, and remember to stay awesome!